Hello, and welcome to episode 3 of my First Reef Aquarium. In the previous episodes, we explained how a reef system works and listed the essential equipment needed to make it happen. In this episode, we assembled equipment and prepare everything for the tank cycling process. Before we begin, be extremely careful when dealing with both water and electricity. This is the tank we'll be setting up, the all-in-one plug-and-play Max Nano Peninsula. We are placing it in a spot that complies with the criteria detailed in episode 1. The floor is sturdy and leveled, there is no direct sunlight, and the system has a designated electrical socket. The only thing missing is a nearby water faucet and drainage, which is helpful, but not a must. We start with the cabinet. You assemble it by following the instructions, just like any other cabinet. When you're done, place the empty glass aquarium on top and then level it. Leveling the aquarium properly is critical, because if for some unforeseen reason the aquarium isn't leveled, its structural integrity may be compromised. We proceed with our essential equipment list. If you won't be choosing a complete all-in-one system, make sure that every piece of equipment you're about to get physically fits its designated spot in your chosen system, and carefully follow the setup instructions when you install each device. In this case, it's an all-in-one system, so we simply slide everything into its place. The return pump, double check that it's firmly connected to the return outlet, the carbon, a bubble trap filter sponge, the protein skimmer, and lighting. In most systems, you will need to figure out the right height for setting your lighting. A light unit needs to be high enough so the spot right beneath it is not overlit, and low enough so it spreads the maximal amount of light inside the tank with minimal spillage. Of course, since this is an all-in-one system, the lighting has already been set for you at the right height. By the way, if you're planning on getting a truly large system, you will also need to calculate the number of light units needed to supply homogeneous light cover for the whole tank. The Max Nano Peninsula here already provides you with sufficient circulation and filtration for growing soft corals and LPS corals. But as you advance in this hobby, you might decide you want to grow small polyp stony corals, or SPS for short, which are more delicate and challenging. If you do go for SPS, you should consider enhancing the circulation with the help of wave pumps. For more info on wave pumps, go to the link in the description below. Okay, now that the electrical gear is in place, we need to connect it. The Max Nano Peninsula here comes with a built-in power center with conveniently located on-off switches, so that's covered. But if you choose another system, please ensure all your electric cords are safely located and neatly organized. Regardless of what system you get, each and every cable must have a drip loop, which is done like this, thereby preventing water from dripping into the electrical outlet. Next, the live rocks. If you've purchased natural live rocks and not man-made ones, you will need to remove any unwanted tiny hitchhikers before placing the rocks in the aquarium. This is an extremely safe and easy procedure. For more info, see the link below. Once you've cleaned your rocks, we can begin aquascaping, which is the art of crafting a stony bed for your corals to grow on. This phase determines to a large degree the look of your future reef. So get inspired. Check out photos of natural reefs and other reef tanks. A good place where you can see some amazing reef tanks is the Red Sea Owners Group on Facebook, down below. After you figure out what you want, spread some newspaper on a flat surface and build a test scape. Place the rocks on top of each other, constantly verifying that the structure is stable and that it looks good from all angles. If you need to, you can chisel parts of the live rocks, or you can glue them together with some epoxy glue. When it comes to the aquascaping itself, here are some important pointers. 1. Keep the design simple. Do not overcomplicate. 2. Create some small caves and nooks for the fish to hide in or catch a nap. 3. Make sure that the rocks are not blocking the return outlet or the wave pumps if you plan on using any. 4. Avoid creating areas where there is no flow, otherwise organic waste will accumulate there instead of being filtered away. 5. Avoid putting the rocks too close to the surface of the water, because you will be needing that room for coral growth. We recommend to go as high as 2/3 of the total water height. When you are done test scaping and happy with the result, gently place the rocks in the aquarium and be careful not to scratch the glass or drop the rocks. Moving on to the substrate. Use either your hands or a small container and spread the substrate evenly between 2 to 5 centimeters high or 1 or 2 inches. Any less will not provide sufficient biological filtration, and more will mean frequent substrate maintenance and unwanted anaerobic zones. Don't spend too much time on evening the substrate, since it will probably move a bit once you've added the water. Which brings us to the salt water. If you haven't already prepared your mix, now is the time. For detailed instructions on which salt to use and how to prepare a perfect salt water mix, see the two videos in the description below. When the salt mix is ready, you just pour it in. Whether you do that with a small container or a hose in a pump, do it very slowly so you don't start up a sandstorm. Finally, the heater or chiller, assuming you need one. This one is also pretty simple. Just follow the manufacturer instructions, set the temperature to 25 to 26 degrees Celsius or 77 to 79 degrees Fahrenheit, then place it in your sump. Everything is now ready. All that is left to do is turn on the power, then press the link to the next episode where we begin the tank cycling process. So see you there.